Our guest today on the Elena and Natalia show is the founder and host of Hope Generation. And we have him on the show today to share his words of wisdom and hopefully to inspire you as well. Ben is a speaker, author, pastor, and travels all around the world preaching and teaching the good news, the gospel. And we have some more good news for you. He'll also be answering questions directly sent in from fans and friends of Hope Generation, aka the Hope Generators. Yes, so grab your favorite snacks and join us with our hope-tastic friend, Ben Courson.
I survived because the fire inside me burned brighter than the fire around me. God is a consuming fire and He is in me, so the storm cannot take me where God cannot keep me. Wrong will be worsted, right will triumph. We are baffled to fight better. We sleep to wake, we fall to rise. We might have hell around us, but we have heaven inside of us. We bear a cross today, but we are gonna wear a crown tomorrow. We are the people that have gone through hell and walked out of the flames carrying buckets of water for those still consumed by the fire.
Recently, we were in church, yes, and the worship leader was singing, and she said that she felt that the Lord put it on her heart to, that comparison was really one of the main reasons for suicide. And comparison and a spirit of suicide.
I'm really excited to talk about this because this will be practical for
exactly
people.
And on social media, we can't escape it nowadays. We're going to see it everywhere. We turn on the internet, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram.
At Elena Natalia. At Ben _
Shout out. Plug.
Shameless
swipe
plug.
Up merch in bio.
We don't have the swipe up feature.
I know, I'm joking.
In a not
we
yet.
Don't. You do.
Swipe up for merch. I don't have merch either.
Yeah.
Actually.
Next month.
Yeah, next month.
I don't know.
Hoodies. Next month. I'm just joking.
So social media and comparison. Do you think there is a link between comparison and suicide?
Yes.
Okay.
Comparison is the thief of joy.
Yes.
And we compare our behind the scenes with other people's highlight reels. I'm not saying social media isn't true. I'm saying it's a half-truth.
Right.
And what you're not, nobody says, hashtag worst day ever, my life's awful. No,
it's
you're posting yourself in Hawaii.
Things, it's, especially
like,
Instagram.
Honestly, I look at my own Instagram and I'm like, that's like part of my life. But most of my life is me sitting on an airplane reading books.
Then post that.
Well, I
do that.
Maybe I should.
Yeah,
I heard a guy say, I would follow an Instagram account that just posted a guy like putting my dog away, going to get dog food at the store.
Every
just
day.
Like the everyday stuff. But yeah, it's and this social media thing, it's comparison is the thief of joy.
Absolutely. And nowadays, social media, you said, don't use social media to impress people,
use it to
impact people. And there's just so much influence on this platform. How about if there is someone who is currently feeling discouraged because they want to use social media to have impact and to impact people, but they have really low numbers on social media? Do numbers equal influence?
I think quantity is not always synonymous with quality.
Okay. That's good.
I mean,
there are
over 10,000 videos on YouTube.
Yeah.
With a billion hits. 10,000 videos on YouTube with a
with
billion
that process.
Hits. Yeah, I had to like, I was like, no. And what are they? Cat videos.
Get a cat.
There we go. That's influence. Yeah. How do you get influenced? Buy a cat and post it.
But
my point is,
Benji
like,
the cat.
I think Paul the Apostle used the highest technology of his day, the Persian mailing system, the dictation of letters. So too, I think it's important not to fight against technology, but to wield it to important effect. Social media is the marketplace of our generation.
Yeah.
But that doesn't always mean that quantity is synonymous with quality 100% of the time.
Okay.
There are very, very influential people that don't have big social media followings. Like, you guys have a TV show. Like, you have to go through gatekeepers to get here. This is crazy. You're 27, you have a TV show. How many 27-year-old girls have a TV show? That's crazy.
Thank you.
On the other hand, you have some people who have a million followers. There's actually a rap song. I haven't heard it. A friend told me about it. But he said there's a
rap
song.
Can you rap it?
No, I've never heard this song.
Yeah, you can.
But the lyric is, you have a million followers, but you can't fix the bumper on your car.
Oh.
Because that was trolling. So you can have a lot of followers, and that doesn't always mean that you have a ton of influence. Now, sometimes it does, obviously, but I'm saying it's not always that binary.
Yeah, and I think it's so important to use the numbers you have, whether it be 10, whether it be 100, whether it be a million,
they all mean something.
To make a difference, because we don't know the quotes that we're posting, the pictures that we're posting can have the power to save lives. And especially as believers, we have that influence to be able to, you know, post a quote and evangelize. And you do that so beautifully.
We've made a commitment that every single day we're going to do something to help somebody. Like, we're going to give some sort of hope quote that'll help them today.
And has someone ever reached out to you saying, hey, Ben, you know, your Instagram post saved my life, or testimonies?
It's been crazy. Like, people actually looking forward to that in their day.
Yes.
And then I baptized a girl yesterday who was suicidal, and then I'm giving hope quotes during the message, and she becomes she gets baptized. That's... And she's like, I was suicidal and I came here.
Wow.
So, like, the fact that we get to do what we do, giving people hope, that's what compels us to get up in the morning.
And we all have the opportunity to do that, I believe, as
every
believers who have social media can use it for good.
We all have a sphere of influence.
Yes, yes.
Amen. And whether that's 10 or a million or just your next door neighbor, it's like every person is important. When you start seeing people as souls and not numbers, it automatically changes your perspective. And talking about, you know, solitude, going from loneliness to solidarity.
Yeah,
another sermon we listened to, which was amazing. And then, as you can tell, we're quoting a lot of your stuff today.
You've done your research. You guys are good.
I know. We have a whole list of quotes.
Kind of like, unlike when Larry King had Seinfeld on. He's like, so did you guys get canceled?
We know
he's
you
like,
better than you.
He's like, you seen that? Yeah. When Larry King's like, oh, did you get canceled? And he's like, no, we're the number one show on TV. Do your research.
No.
You guys are the opposite, because you guys did your research.
Yeah, I guess more than they know.
It's like, do you remember this 10 years ago?
I'm just kidding. You wrote this in your journal. I'm kidding. And you also wrote, loneliness expresses the pain of being alone, and solitude expresses the glory of being alone.
Yeah, this is important.
Expresses the glory of being alone. Yeah. So is solitude the positive of loneliness?
Exactly. Yes. There's a difference between solitude and loneliness.
Yeah.
Solitude is empowering. Too much solitude can bleed over into loneliness.
Right.
And that's why I think Jesus modeled it at the Garden of Gethsemane, because we've kind of had this suicidal theme going on. When Jesus was at his moment of death, he said, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto the point of death, the sickness unto death. What does he do? He goes with his disciples into the Garden of Gethsemane, hangs out with them. And notice how the first Adam went into the Garden of Eden alone, and God said it's not good for a man to be alone. The last Adam, that's what Romans calls Jesus, goes into the garden together, from solitude to solidarity. Remember, the first Adam had to work by the sweat of his brow, expelled from the garden.
Yes.
The last Adam, Jesus, bleeds from the sweat of his brow in the garden to reverse the curse and redeem Adam's work. There's a bunch of cool parallels.
Amazing.
They're both called the image of God, Adam, and then Colossians calls Jesus the image of God. So he's there with his disciples together from solitude to solidarity. The last Adam models that. But then he said, stay here while I go and pray. Then he went alone to pray, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my, but thy will be done. Comes back to his disciples. It's like he's getting recharged, goes back into solitude, recharged back and forth. So I feel like that back and forth is very, very important.
Yes.
Like for me, I need to take my morning studying and really reading and building knowledge and writing my book and all that stuff. So I'm doing that in the morning, but then in the afternoon, I really try to get around friends and and that's been a really healthy ebb and flow.
Don't isolate, infiltrate.
Yes, because solitude is glory, loneliness is pain.
How about for those people who want to infiltrate, but they've been stuck in isolation that they don't even know what the next steps to take, or they do make the effort to join a church community, but they feel kind of scared to approach someone?
Yeah.
What tips would you give them if they say, oh, my personality is more shy?
Yeah. Fun is fundamental.
Okay. Fun is fundamental. Just have fun.
Fun is fundamental. Go around the people who bring you life.
Right. And like, that's important for friendships. Friendships that bring life.
Yes.
If you want to go fast, go alone.
If you want to go far, go together.
I like it.
Yeah.
You're together.
The Bible says a friend sticks closer than a brother. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together.
You've heard of the man trying hard to die, and still got some acceptance. Give it to me!
found it so interesting that the winning word for the National Spelling Bee, I don't know if you heard, was koinonia, which means...
I did hear that.
Yeah.
Fellowship. Yeah.
Pop quiz. You need to spell koinonia.
K-O-I... Wait. Ooh. I'm going to try. Do you have it spelled there? I'm going to try. Here's my trivia.
I'm
awful at spelling. K-O-I-N... O-N-I-A.
Yes!
No! Halfway through, I thought I lost the plot.
You did it! Wow!
I was convinced I had lost the
plot. You're not horrible at spelling.
Wow.
That's the winning word.
Yeah, so that means that's the key to winning a life. Koinonia, fellowship with God.
Isn't that interesting?
And with man. Yeah. You can have one without the other.
Oh, cool. So you're saying just as they won at the spelling bee through koinonia, we win at life through fellowship.
Yeah.
Amen. You got it.
I have attracted tribe. Boom.
That was prophetic. Prophetic that the winning word.
I realized I didn't ask a question. Just wanted to make a statement.
Okay, so thankfully we have a community here, the three of us on the show. And now it's Ask Ben time. Questions
from
your hope generators or our friends.
I feel like your friends are asking these questions.
Yes, thank you to our lovely friends.
Next time, well, we got to get the hope generators more involved.
Yeah. Yeah, but our lovely friends sent in some questions for you.
Thank you, ladies.
Surly at Surly Nuz wants to know, Ben, how do you, and she has two questions. So the first one is, how do you discern what is God's will and what isn't?
Okay, this is a softball again.
Okay.
Paul said, let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Mm. The word rule in Greek is umpire.
Umpire.
It's literally where we get our word umpire. So it means umpire. How do you know if God's calling you out or if he's saying this is a safe decision to make, safe or out? Mm. By the peace in your heart.
Wow.
So God will give you a shalom. Peace in the Bible is not a placidity of negative nothingness, a nirvana of just abysmal, you know, just like... flatline. Uh-huh. Peace in the Bible, shalom, the Hebrew idea, is everything that makes for a person's highest good. In fact, sin has been defined as disturbing the shalom.
Okay.
So like...
the opposite of sin.
The opposite of Eden. So ultimately, shalom, peace, that when you have a peace in your heart, you're like, whoa, I have a deep shalom about
peace.
This.
Okay.
So that's how you know whether it's safe or out. Do what you know and you'll know what to do. And if you don't know... the best thing is just to not do anything.
So if they don't have
106
peace,
times the Bible says wait for God. Yes.
Wait for God. If they don't have peace about a decision, what's the next step? Do they fast? Do they pray until they find that peace?
Well, the 106 times wait for God.
You wait
for the Lord.
Literally wait in worship or wait actively?
Well, wait. Like if somebody comes to you and waits a table, it's active waiting.
And they serve waiting.
They serve.
So you keep doing that with the Lord, actively waiting on him. But I have never regretted waiting when I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
And I've never regretted following my peace. Psalm 37 says, seek peace and pursue it.
Amen.
Pursue the peace.
Seek peace.
Hey, that'll be a message right there.
Seek peace and pursue the shalom peace. That answers Sarah's question. The next one she has is, what and how is the best way to share the good news with people in the current society given the liberalism of today's culture?
That's a good one, Sarah.
I read that question, I want to hear it too.
Well, I think it's important that when we're talking about the word liberalism, that implies the donkey.
Okay.
Conservatism implies the elephant. Jesus in his day, he called Herod a fox, which meant a pretender. Okay. And ultimately, the Roman Empire was the eagle.
Okay,
so the Roman Empire was the eagle. That was their national symbol. So he said, foxes have holes, birds have nests. The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head.
Yes.
Rome and the Herodian kings, they're about the accumulation of wealth through avaricious, violent greed and warfare, but my kingdom's about peacemaking. Mm-hmm. So it's not about donkeys, elephants, foxes, or eagles. It's about the lion and the lamb. Mm-hmm. So I think when we're at a place where we're saying, it's not about fighting one political side or the other. It's about saying, I am an ambassador for the kingdom of God. And the Bible says his loving kindness will draw him into repentance. Repent in Greek is metanoia, which means to change the way you think. Meta, metamorphosize, noia, think. To change the way you think. The best way to get people to change the way that they think about God, because how you perceive God dictates how you receive from God. And even neurological, scientific, sociological, psychological research has shown us that what you think about God is the most important thing about you. If you think he's grumpy and cruel, you'll be grumpy and cruel and unforgiving. If you see him as love, you're going to be a much more forgiving person. So if you want people to see the God you see, then what you have to do is image him in the lives of the people around you so they can have a model and representation of you putting feet to your faith and you mirroring the invisible attributes of God to the world, which is our teleologic design to be the image of God. That's what
I would say.
Beautiful.
Beautifully said.
Minelli at mean, not M-E-A-N, M-E-E-N underscore E-L-Y, she's really nice, yeah. asks, how do you remain joyful when the storms of life hit hard? It's so easy to think God doesn't love me or I did something wrong and he's punishing me. So how do you keep yourself from believing
yeah.
that?
God doesn't do things to us. Hmm. He does things for us.
Amen.
Jacob, when he thought Joseph died, he said, all these things are against me. When Joseph, about 18 chapters later, or maybe 8 chapters later, Joseph,
18.
I'm bad at math.
Between there.
Joseph, his son, when his brothers betrayed him, he said, what you meant for evil, the Lord meant for good. Do you see the dichotomy there?
Yeah.
His dad says, oh, all these things are against me. Joseph says, no, these things are for me. And you've got to remember that everything you're going through right now, the pain is in service of your destiny. And the situations that you see as painful, God is converting those situations into pain fuel that are actually going to drive you toward your destiny.
Amen. Amen. I hope that encouraged you.
So count it all joy.
Count it all joy. Sometimes we think count it all joy. Well, it's explained here.
Oh, can I say one more thing?
Yeah.
Because I have a heart for that. And I know we're going long. But here's the thing. Remember how in the book of Psalms it says God is enthroned on the flood?
Yeah.
In Genesis, this is nutty. In Genesis, when the flood happened, remember a rainbow came and the rainbow is the promise that the earth would never flood again. And then in Revelation, we're told that God's throne is surrounded by rainbows. So there's a connection from Genesis beginning, Psalms connection. Middle, Revelation, the
it's
end.
All
so
a big
that
story,
means
a puzzle.
That, yeah, it's a puzzle. So whenever there is a storm that you're going through, there God is enthroned in that flood. He's not surprised by it. He's, he's ruling on it. And there's a rainbow surrounding that throne, a promise. For every problem you go through, there's a promise from God to solve it.
It's an eternal rainbow.
Yes.
Everlasting. Amen.
Did you hear that, though? With every problem we face, there's a promise to solve it.
Amen.
With every flood, there's a rainbow.
There's never a problem that's too big to for God, right?
Yes.
Amen.
And are those colors subjective?
Well, that's why you can't grab
People
them. That's
the
why you
colors.
Can't grab the rainbow, because it's all
sparkly.
It's a play on your corneal retina. Anyways.
Lara Lisa underscore B, Lara asks, I know God is in control of all things, but that doesn't mean that bad things won't happen to us in life. So how can we let go of anxiety and fearful thoughts of losing loved ones on earth, even though we have the assurance of heaven?
Like going from caterpillar to butterfly, like going from womb to world, like going from watching the Minions movie to watching Star Wars. That's how great the jump is going to be from this life to the next.
Right.
You know what holds majority support among all of humanity? Most human beings, no matter what tribe, religion, culture, tongue, they believe in an afterlife. Ecclesiastes says God has put eternity in our hearts.
Yeah,
God has not put desires in us to frustrate us, but to fulfill us. That desire for eternity that you have, the reason you don't have to be anxious about loved ones dying is because you know that God put eternity in your heart, not to frustrate you, but to fulfill it. He has swallowed up death in victory. 1 Corinthians 15 says that word victory in Greek is Nike.
Yeah,
so he's
that.
The ultimate victory, swallowed up death in Nike.
That's it.
That
so Lada, he swallowed up death in Nike.
Victory.
No fear, no
fear.
Zero fear.
Amen.
Zip. So Aleida Ariaga actually has a question for all of us to chime in. She mentions that she's been told that she would be great at public speaking and is not afraid of sharing the gospel to friends and strangers.
Good
That's
for
great.
You.
God has put it on her heart to start a blog or YouTube series about worship tips and Bible messages, but sometimes questions if she's good enough or worthy to do it. So since we each host our own shows, Hope Generation, and inspire others, she'd like tips on how to start her journey and hold on to her faith if she does eventually decide to go for it.
Yeah, the 10,000-hour rule was what helped me the most, and that's just 4 hours a day, 5 days a week for 10 years. Now, a lot of people can't do that. They're like, I don't have that time.
Where are we at, 1,000?
No, a lot of
this much interviews.
A lot of people are
surpassed that. No
well, I did 11,073 hours in 5 years, and I actually counted them.
Oh,
so,
5 years.
You should write a book on that.
Oh, it's in my book.
It's, yes.
That's coming out in March, but that's still a ways out. I'm super excited.
We'll be the first to read
it.
Send us a copy.
We'll do a fun interview about it once it comes out.
Yeah, I would love to.
If you guys want, that'll be fun.
The Optimist Fits?
Optimist Fits, Igniting a Fierce
Coming
Rebellion
out
Against
March?
Helplessness. March 2019.
I can't wait.
Excited.
So, but the other thing is, like, Billy Graham got his start speaking to alligators. Some people,
really?
C.H. Spurgeon told in lectures to my students, his protégés who wanted to be preachers, he said, you focus, so many young people are focused on when are they going to get their opportunity.
Exactly.
He said, you focus on your ability, God will take care of your opportunity.
That's it. Yes.
And so you focus That's on all. Your ability. You're like, nobody's listening to me. Do you have somebody in your sphere of influence who would love to hear from you? Do you have stuffed animals at home? Do you have alligators near the lake.
A cat.
Like, honestly, a lot of my speaking came from just speaking to walls.
Really?
Yes, and that's it's a muscle that you practice. So people are more afraid of public speaking than death. It's the number one greatest human
fear. And
you have
no fear of public speaking.
I mean, I get butterflies, but like,
that's good.
Make friends with the butterflies. That shows you're alive.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah, that shows you're alive.
That's
but,
true.
Yeah, you'd
be
no
a robot
fear.
If you weren't.
Yeah, but no fear. I think butterflies and fear are different. Fear is paralyzing. Butterflies are motivating.
Yes, butterflies are freeing. We love butterflies.
Butterflies make you fly.
Yeah.
Hallmark card vibes. So focus on your ability. God will take care of your opportunity.
Amen. I love it. That's encouraging.
Yeah, go for it. We can't wait to read your blog or YouTube video.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
Don't be afraid. Don't hold back. If you have the fire in your heart, I know that God will equip you, because if it's God's will, well, yeah, it's his bill.
Yeah, there you go.
God has put a story in your heart, and you need to share that story with the world, and he's going to put a new song in your mouth as well, and just speak it out. Speak life, speak the words of God. If you don't know what to say, open the word and speak that out. That's most important, and he'll speak through you. Yes, go for it.
Walking with God was meant to be fun. Changing the world is not only something that's going to be fun, but fun is also exactly what's going to change the world.
Action!
So we've been having a lot of fun, Ben. We're almost done, but we never like ending the show without some ministry time and prayer. And we know last time you prayed such a beautiful prayer of hope for our friends. And we just feel it in our heart, especially nowadays with the suicide going on and getting even worse and the depression. And people need hope. And most importantly, they need salvation. And if there is someone who says, you know what, I want that salvation of Jesus Christ, the hope that's only found in him. Can you say a salvation prayer for them?
Yeah, I'd love to pray.
Wonderful. We love that.
Lord, we thank you so much that you show us the story of the master of heaven who would bankrupt the kingdom to sell everything he has to buy us the pearl of great price, that you would go to the ends of the earth, even a cross, to prove your love for us. Lord, speaking of saving and suicide, there are a lot of people who need to be saved even right now from suicide, from depression. And I think of Peter when he was sinking, he just said, Lord, save me. And you said, we're not heard for our much speaking. So those who are sinking into depression, I pray that they would just cry out, Lord, save me. Whoever calls in the name of the Lord will be saved. And I pray, Lord God, that you would give hope to the hurting. Lord, I pray that you would be the one who, even as is found in scriptures, you would cause the lame to leap, the blind to see, the mute to speak, the deaf to hear, the dead to raise. I pray that you would apply the healing balm of Gilead to people who are wounded so deeply, caring about these secret festering wounds left untreated. I pray that you would give the nepenthe, the panacea, the cure-all, the Eden eatables for the healing of the nations, that you would give encouragement, nourishment to these people, that all these truths that we've talked about today, all these hope quotes, all these scriptures, all these historical, scientific references, all the things we talked about, I pray that this would come together into a whole package that would give a lot of people hope right now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Ben.
Yes, we had an amazing
time. I love this. I look forward to this.
We do too.
Like just sometimes when I'm on the plane, I'm like, I'm just thinking of, oh, I wonder where I'm going, you know? And then when I'm on the plane, I'm like, get up from my reading and come back to the surface. And I'm like, oh, yes, I get to go on the Elena and Natalia show. I'm just so excited.
That's a full name.
I know. Am I pronouncing it right yet? It's taken me two times.
The Elena
and Natalia show.
I mean, it's taken us quite a while.
Who's Elena?
The Elena and Natalia show.
Who's Elena?
You're Natalia.
Yeah.
I know. You just tricked me for a second. I'm like, is this a trick? Yeah.
You know, I'm Elena. She's
Natalia and Elena.
You got it
How long
right.
does it take people to tell you apart?
Not long.
It depends. Some, like, I was shocked. We had friends who still couldn't tell us apart. I'm like, if you're a friend, you have to tell us apart. What is this prophecy?
You don't look alike as much as you talk alike. Okay. You have twin voices. So twins always look alike.
I always thought my voice
alike.
Was deeper than hers, though. She had a little softer.
I'm a bit congested.
Oh, so I sound congested.
You guys sound alike to me.
Over the phone, we're exactly the same.
Yes.
Well, you're in person, so you're confirming that you sound. I think our personalities are a bit
and you guys make it even harder because your Instagram is Elena and Natalia.
I know.
You don't have a separate.
Everyone forces us to get separate. We're like, there's no competition.
We have the same friends. We don't want competition. It's for the ministry.
God forbid she has 50 and I have 51.
5 followers. It's not happening. We need the same.
Together we're stronger, remember?
I know. There
in
you
the
go.
Future.
I was kind of hoping you guys would make me mad during this interview because I just thought of how cool it'd be to throw. I've seen so many people like throw the mic down and like.
I thought you were
going to
say throw
mic.
Ice.
You guys are too nice.
Throw
I
your
can't
salt
get mad.
Shaker at
I could. I
oh,
could
yeah.
Did it's we, just so like.
Did we mention your brain?
It takes a boss to do that. I could never do that.
Be mean. No, don't be mean.
I think you guys are incapable of being mean. I will say I love this show.
Thank you.
And everybody watching, I just want to say, I don't know which camera I'm looking into.
Promotion.
But everybody watching, this is an amazing show. Keep watching this channel. I'm so excited to be on it with Hope Generation.
ICFN.
The Elena and Natalia show. Yeah. This is an incredible thing that is reaching the nations.
You're
you know,
amazing.
It's reaching the nations. So I love this station and I love this show.
So sweet.
And I love your guys' commitment to excellence.
Thank you. We're happy to have your programs on International Christian Family Network.
Yes.
ICFN is people. The network you're reaching a lot of Armenians, a lot of international communities. So
yes. I just love it. Your life
go,
is
go,
on
go.
The go for the Lord and He's just gonna bless you in insurmountable, exponential ways.
Ooh, wow. Good sentence.
So we
you're
end
very
on
nice.
That.
And God's blessings on your book for March. And
we're just excited
more books
for you.
In the future and more reaching the millions and billions.
Okay.
Yeah. Billions.
Billions.
Trillions.
Because our brain holds billions.
Counting aliens and all the species.
Yes.
On the
Amen.
So now
all of creation is longing for redemption, Romans
Amen.
Says.
Dear friends, we so appreciate you tuning in to another episode of the Elena and Natalia Show. We so hope you are blessed by our very hope-tastic friend, Ben Courson.
Hope-tastic?
Hope-tastic. We said it. We know we were surely blessed, and he's just so wise. But most importantly, he loves the Lord. We ask that you go support him, follow his Instagram, his social media platforms, @Ben_Courson. Yes,
I get said the it underscore.
The underscore Courson. And if you want to check out his website and see where he's traveling next to meet him, go on his website, bencourson.com.
And I hate to put a shameless plug, but we also love you.
We have to.
At Elena Natalia TV. Yes, we do share an Instagram, but don't let that scare you off, please. Just come and follow. Maybe we'll follow back. Yes, we will. We'll follow back.
And swipe up for merch.
We don't have that yet.
I'm joking because that's the new, that's the thing.
Yeah,
I need to swipe up for merch.
Don't swipe right or left. I don't know the difference. And before we say goodbye for now, though you may encounter trials and hardships in this life, be encouraged because, as it says in 1 Peter 1:6, be truly glad because
there is
wonderful joy ahead.
Wonderful, not just joy, but wonderful joy. Yes, let that sink in. Thank you so much.
And let's make a transition.
Ciao.
The camera.
Ciao
for now.
Ciao for now.
We love you all.
Ciao for now.
Love you guys.
Bye.